Hey, hello everyone. Hello, welcome, good evening. My name is Steven Vitticio. I'm the director and chief curator of the Blaffer Art Museum. It is amazing to see so many of you here tonight. Please give yourself a round. Truly, thank you. Thank you for coming out and supporting young artists and the performances that are taking place here. Welcome to Convergence Research. This is a program that the Blaffer Art Museum and the Mitchell Center for the Arts co-present and co-produce. So I want to, again, welcome you on behalf of Melissa Noble, my co-director at the Mitchell Center, and everyone here at the Blaffer. We've had a fantastic semester, or season of Convergence Research. Saul Hernandez, Marley Foster, Veronica Gaona. We've had fantastic performances and we're so excited to welcome you to tonight's performance, which was conceived and orchestrated by Kat Martinez. So just in brief, I'm going to hand it over to Melissa to speak a little bit to introduce Kat properly, but just in broad strokes, Convergence Research is here for you and your students, faculty, alumni, to try out interdisciplinary ideas. If you've got an idea for a group, if you want to be ambitious or experimental or adventurous, let us know. Reach out to us. We're always accepting new proposals. We're always open to ideas. This program is animated and grows through artists in this community. So again, thank you for supporting, and we welcome your future ideas and contributions. I want to give a special thanks to Caitlin Jones, who is the curator of tonight, and who will be leading a Q&A afterwards. So please stick around if you'd like to learn more about the performance. But for now, I'm going to hand the mic over to Melissa to introduce Kat.
Yes, thank you again for coming. And Caitlin B. Jones is the graduate assistant for this year from the Arts and Leadership Program. She's been doing a fabulous job curating all of these shows for the entire year of Convergence Research. Kat Martinez is a mixed media sculptor who works with metal, fiber, and mold making. She delves into topics of race and ethnicity and humor to debunk untruths and her wit and work, and often uses abstract representations of significant moments in her life. She has a BFA in sculpture from the age and is currently an ethnic sculptor as well as a student. And she is a community artist of the Eager Black Performance Art Collective and a former project of the Waterfall as well. This program is made in collaboration with Mia Leiter, Mia Mcfoggy, along with Saran Albertson, Luna Vega, and Randy Long. Please enjoy Joseph T. Long. Chevy May, Stay St. George, 18th Century, Dressing Please no flash photography or videos. Thank you.
Thank you. program is within the Whitfield Center for the Arts. And I just have one word to say.
Wow.
How did you come to know Joseph Malone and what part of this amazing performance?
Well, I came to know Joseph Malone from Dr. Anne Lundy. She's a mentor of mine. She's the first female black female observer in the Houston Symphony, and she researches lesser known. Black composers, and so her work in Houston really highlighted Joseph Malone for me, and I started reading, and I found that Joseph Malone was born in 1745, and he was of Senegalese descent and French descent, and his father being a nobleman in France brought him back, and I found that Joseph Malone, he was not your average individual. He rose to start everything he did, he succeeded. He was a wonderful marksman, swordsman, then later on violin virtuoso, as well as like a really talented composer. And so just digging into him, I'm like, this is a rock star. He's a rock star for his time. And hanging out with the most elite, like with the dignitaries like the Prince of Wales, dignitaries like Maria Antoinette and her husband. And so further digging and finding out this person's music, it was not known for like 200 years until Silver. So I just had to research.
You collaborate, correct me if I'm wrong, this is the first time that you have costume design as part of the whole thing.
That's right.
And you collaborated with three possibly the theater department and wanted to be as historically accurate as possible. Can you talk about that process?
Yes. So, Paige Wilson and the professor and the theater department that spoke of costume design, she spoke of the extent of what 20th century Paris's life. I wanted to know what a day in the life of Joseph Malone would be like, working with his singers, what the opera was, how they were expected to look and dress. And so being able to incorporate that regalia dress around that, I really just wanted to bring out the fact of the clothing and the whole it's like a whole play of putting on this to get dressed.
Can you talk about what are some of the themes that you have in mind as you're crafting these costumes? But we see the huge reveal of the Vincent. We also see him at the Vincent and the Steel posters. Can you talk about about how those are integrated and more?
Well, I wanted to make sure that I captured the robot process, and you're seeing this one in the blue white, as well as Mahogany. She had the red robot process. It was very important to capture that because that was very much what they would have been wearing then, as well as the panier. But the panier is my sculptural portion. They're way over there. They're exaggerated. They wouldn't have anything on near that. And you saw it at a time with the mannequin because they're just really extremely heavy. And just to bring out and highlight the heaviness on Joseph Malone, the theme there, because not only was he a great composer, he also was a great military man in the French Revolution. Joseph Malone, he had to drop all those findings alive, and he fought for the revolution because he knew that within also the black code that was going on in France, where there were not equal rights. And so the heaviness of that is brought out in that piece. Also, the Senegalese ancestry is brought out in these colorful petticoats that she was wearing, that Mahatma was wearing, and also the right headgear is Senegalese in origin. So I wanted to bring out those features and in that system.
Can any of the performers talk about the process of rehearsing this piece? What was it like to perform these 200-year-old or over 200-year-old pieces?
Well, for me, I am I'm a classically trained vocalist, but I sing also sing other genres. I'm not sure if you can tell, but French is not my first language. So, and I had not sang in French in at least 5 years. So when Kat called me to do this project with her, I immediately pulled the score and I said, "Oh gosh, she's in French. Let me go back and brush up on my college." Let me go back and brush up on my French. And sometimes when I'm learning the notes, sometimes I want to refer to a recording. So I was trying to find a recording of this opera, and it was pretty much non-existent. I managed to find maybe one recording, and it was by the grace of God that I found it. Because I like to see what kind of rhythm the other singers use, and you know, just kind of get some ideas from what I'm doing. But the process was pretty tedious, but I really, really enjoyed it, especially when I did more research on Joseph Long. Yeah, it was really, really fun. Thank you so much for putting in this.
Hello, my name is Leah. I'm a first year master's student here at the New York School of Music. So to revive a 200-year-old opera was nothing. We're right now doing Julius Caesar by Handel, which is actually a little bit older than this opera, it's a different style. But to revive an opera that has not been done in 200 years was interesting, because there were no editorial markings. And all the scores now, ones are Handel, Beethoven, Bach. There are markings galore, some we have to argue about. In this, the score was basically empty. And I did notice some musical things. You saw that I did some coloratura runs. Those are not really written in the score as runs, but I felt that musically it would have been appropriate to do so. I also improvised at the end to add a very nice line now. Because, again, the score was left so blank that the implication was to improvise, like in Handel, there's a lot of empty measures, and it's assumed the performer would know to improvise there. So yeah, I think it was really great to do this work, and I'm really excited to see where this opera goes. Now the opera did it last year, so thank you.
For another collaborator to talk about their process. Anything that came up to you, waiting on these beautiful ladies, having the experience, what was the difference? Like, oh, it's always me. So, just so you know, if Kat says that she wants to do something, I'm the first person to be like, sure, I'll go. And really, it was so exciting to see the passion that she has, and she really gets her hooks into bit of research. She gets so excited. She gets you excited. So I was really excited to brush out my fashion history to be like, yeah, those things are called paniers. And like, they're called paniers because they look like bowls of bread, like paniers. And so it was nice to be able to touch back to my fashion roots to help my beautiful, smart, intelligent, wonderful brand make but I do want to ask Kat about Convergence Research, and you know, it's a platform for interdisciplinary collaboration. Where do you see this going? Is there more interdisciplinary collaboration in the future for any of you? and how does this want to expand it?
Yeah, I'll talk a bit about what I would like to say for the future. I do have another science on scientific, and so I'm thinking about remediation with plants, and it was stemming from an original study I had back in the town, which is quite simple about that, but it's over 100 years old, that was found it, and the soil was polluted, and so in that I will explore my sculptural practice, but I also kind of want some advice from the scientific partners here at the school. And so the Convergence Research will be very helpful in making that merge happen, and so that the piece will be sound and solid piece. I know it's a completely different, this is a piece of love that is here, but the remediation of science will be moving into that. But my cohort here today also are thinking about Convergence Research.
And so hi, my name is Loma. I'm a first year MFA student, sculptor as well. Thank you so much for being part of this. So when I heard about the research, Convergence Research, immediately I thought I need to contact you because my art is all related with human behavior, stimuli, everything around psychology. So I do see in the near future some collaboration and integration with the psychology department, so that same as you mentioned, my art is also sound and the effect that it can do in the world more than just, you know, an object and show to people, but to actually have the viewer activated and just think beyond what it is.
Absolutely, and that's what Convergence Research is all about. I want to open it up to questions from the audience, if anybody has any questions for any of these lovely people.
So I just wanted to know, what was the process like when you came to the reversing and putting it on? Because I saw you on your strategic when you put on the pants and did you put it all together?
Yes, there is a specific way of doing this, and so I am not reinventing the wheel, guys. There was steps to this process, and so I make sure that I took those steps within, you know, my budget. and create it. Like with the robot process, this is a found object. So I was able to alter it for Amia, and I was also able to the world portion, I was able to alter it for Mahogany as well. But everything else I was able to like sew on my own and find an object, because my mom had a theater company and I would sew with her. But each step of the dressing process, I try to be as accurate as possible within reason to getting each remark ready. And everyone facilitated in that. Well, I do come from a musical family on my mother's side. They were very religious. They were like them coming up in the 1920s and 30s. They even thought some of the gospel music was getting too racy, and so like their outlet was classical music. So it was, you know, a different family, you know, than what you would find in South Mississippi. But I had an uncle to go on to go to New York, and a aunt to go to New York. My uncle, he was a concert pianist, and I was very much influenced by that. My aunt, she in the late 70s became one of the secrets at the Metropolitan Opera in New York. And so that family influence, we were, whenever family reunions happened, we got together, they were playing music. It was a music event, and people held the piano, and it was just a very fun. From the process, so to be able to incorporate music as a part of my art, this is a dream come true. Ruby does, like really great. And these wonderful singers, I mean, they're amazing. I'm just so lucky to have
them.
Thank
you.
Yeah. And she came in with us less time than any of us. She came in with only about 3.5 weeks of practice, but she's a concert pianist and a smart working HISD middle school teacher. Give it a those steps in the process. You also did not get to see, like, you know, some of the shoe and stocking type process that was left out on that's basically it. What is that answering your question, or was it?
I'm just looking at your more to the back room that is actually happening. Did part of it become more ceremonial and less about getting the dressed?
Oh yeah, they were definitely into, if you're going to have a tea in the garden, you get dressed. And everything was very formal during that time. And so this is just focused on the formality. And kind of teased out to where it's a little extreme, but it was basically pretty much like this from the research that I've done.
Hi. Can you hear me? Yes. So I was just wondering, more so because I don't speak French either, how you came to choose those songs, or if you let them choose, and if you could share a little about what they are speaking of or singing of.
Joseph Lamont, he wrote six operas. Now he wrote several concertos and other symphonies that he wrote. But those operas, they're like a lot of different fragments or, you know, pieces of the opera. Things were kind of tossed around the story of the French Revolution. But how it came about this particular piece, The Accidental Lover, it's one of the more complete pieces, and so I chose it. And it was very accessible thanks to the co-director of the Warner School of Music. She was able to explain to me more about this piece, and I felt that would be appropriate. And it's usually in French, when I talk to her in the box, the director of the Horse Opera House. Usually the French, the operas were comical, and so this really is a comedy, the song that they're singing. And it's about a love triangle. And and our beautiful Amia, she was the lady that is at the center. center of the love triangle and Mahogany is her cover. But maybe they can go more into detail because Amelia, you were sharing with me a funny anecdote about the piece.
So if you look at the plot of the Slaver Nothing Happens, it's basically a woman receives mysterious letters and flowers over time. She gets very frustrated, she wants to meet her mysterious lover. He refuses to show up, and eventually it's revealed that her friend, this count, has been a mysterious lover the whole time. So it's really a love triangle with two people in it. But, you know, that would be the end of the show, right? But no, my character has to have feelings, and that's why the show goes on, and why I sing the aria the way I do. At first, I guess a comparison would be Vanessa and then on to Figaro. At a point, she decides she's against the count, she's no longer going to love him, but then he says her name, so she decides to love him again. And here it's almost the same. I decided against love. I will arm myself against love, which is why he wrote us some very nice vocal rhymes. That was me arming myself. Oh, but then, oh no, I'm inflamed with love. So of course I must continue singing. And yeah, it's really a comical piece because the plot has no meaning. We could just end the opera in the first act. But, right, it's just meant for farce, and I think given the time it was written, which is 1799, about 10 years after the French Revolution, they just wanted to have fun. This is more like Love Actually than some serious French comedy, but yes.
Like she said, the operatic at the end of Act One. But my recitative, which is basically me talking, but singing in spoken voice. Is that right? Right, to recite. I was just basically talking about my annoyance with her. My annoyance with the whole love triangle. The whole story, I'm speaking about that. I hate loves. I can't stand it. I wish they would all leave me alone. I finally have peace, and I'm really glad about it. And yeah, that's why I'm facing the way that I do. That high stems, and I kept repeating the same line over and over again. It was just further me letting you know that I was just super annoyed. I'm really glad this is the album that I'm out of there. Thank
you. Time for one last question. Okay, well, as you can see, Convergence Research is all about interdisciplinary collaboration across the whole city of Houston. So one more round of applause. So come back.